welcome everybody here to Carmel Mountain Christian Church. I know for a fact that God's got something special planned for each and every one of us today. Before we started our service, our ministry workers are in here preparing their coffee and the chairs and getting everything ready. And I said to them, when we were about to pray, I said, so how do you decide and how do you as the individual decide that this Sunday is just not going to be another Sunday where I checked the box, I went to church, I heard a message, I sang a couple songs, shook a few hands, and then I walked off and left. So how do you decide, how do I decide that today is not going to be like every other Sunday? Because some of those things are decisions that are made, and they're made in our heart, that sometimes we have to command ourselves to do certain things. So today, I wasn't here last week, as many of you know, because I went to our corporate offices. We're part of the global apostolic global network, part of that. And so I was at the headquarters last week for a pastor's conference. You ever go somewhere where Jesus' people are and you meet them? I'm going to call it like a mountaintop experience. Anyone here ever have a mountaintop experience? You're like up there with Jesus' people and you're just singing and praising and sound, right? And then you can watch as the days are going by and it's like, you know what, this is going to end and I'm going to have to come down off of the mountain. You ever have that happen? You're like, oh man, but you come back. That's me. I was up on the mountaintop with my brothers and my sisters, other pastors, singing. We had a worship time, word, all that stuff. And then I'm like, you know, I got a 5 or 6 hour flight coming back here, and I got to come back to, quote unquote, the real world. Does that make sense to anybody? That ever happened? And so here I am today, but I'll tell you what, I just know that God has a special message for you guys. He has it for me today, and I believe that God is going to do some great things. Those of you who know me, this is what happened, because you don't see my iPad sitting here, because, you know, normally I'm here with my iPad, and I'm going through stuff. No iPad! No iPad today. I was sitting, and we have a way that we do things here that, you know, on Wednesday or Thursday, I send my message out to our media team. They process it and do all that stuff. So all those fancy slides that you see up there, they come up there with the scriptures and all of that stuff. You guys tracking with me? That's our normal routine. So I came back, got back here Tuesday afternoon. I know I have to process, you know, my message. I actually had my message for today written 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago. And so I opened it up, and I'm in there, and I'm looking at it, and I'm messing with it a little bit. And God whispers to me. He says to me, what you doing? I'm messing with it. I'm like, I'll put this here, put this here. It was like, you know, this isn't making any sense. I'm trying to put things in here, and God is trying to speak directly to me, and this isn't going to work. This isn't going to work. Closed it, put it back in its folder. I'm like, okay, I'm going to yield, God. I'm going to do what you're telling me to do, and I'm not going to. So I wrote to the media team. I'm like, run the slides from last week. I'm just going to get up there. I'm not going to bring my iPad, and I'm just going to let God do what God is going to do today. And I'm going to say what I feel like the words of God are telling me to say, very specific to you. And I'm going to tell you why it's very specific to each and every one of you. Because I believe you're here on assignment. God appointed you to be here, sitting in those seats today, because he's got something special exactly for you today. Heavenly Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those who are watching online, God, that your power would be in the room right with them. And even as they're running back and forth to the kitchen or whatever they're doing, they'll feel the power of your Holy Spirit. And likewise, God, here in this place, I know for a fact that the Spirit of God is here. And the power of God is here as well. So we just pray, God, and we ask for more of your power, more of your strength, more of your Holy Spirit here in this place that's able to pierce through some of the things that we thought, some of the baggage and some of the stuff we brought in here today. The Holy Spirit is going to pierce right through all of that today and come in with a mighty word. And it might come as a still small voice, and it might come as a rushing wind. But you have something planned for these, your people, today. In the name of Jesus. And let the church say, amen. Amen. So, you know, I know, being a pastor and everything, I'm not supposed to get up here and have a message and it doesn't have a title. I mean, what is that? So I'm like, yeah, okay, so I'm going to get up here and I'm going to speak. But what about what, God? He said, tell him this. If you just think you have to have a title, Hudson, call it this. Ask him this question right here. Do you want to be healed? You see, when I say, do you want to be healed, I don't know what you're going through and what you need healing from, but I know someone who does know. That's God. He said, ask him that. Do you want to be healed? That phrase came from John chapter 5, if you want to go look it up. There's a man who's by the pools of Bethesda, and he's waiting to get in the pool of Bethesda so he can be healed. And Jesus comes along, sees this paralytic man who has been paralyzed and can't move, and he comes and asks him the question that I just asked you. He said to him, do you want to be healed? You would think that anyone who has any infirmity, injury, something, sadness, whatever it is, and Jesus or someone comes along and says to them, do you want to be healed? You would think they go, yes. Yes, I do. I can tell you standing here today that that is not true. There are many times I have come up and asked people who I could clearly see had some issues going on, and I said, do you want to be healed, and can I pray for you? And no. You think that a person who was paralyzed and had been so for a while, and Jesus comes up and says, do you want to be healed? They go, yes, Jesus, for sure. But that's just not the way we are as people. I don't understand it, and probably even as I'm saying, you're going, that doesn't sound right, but it's true. I'll ask you again, do you want to be healed? You see, Jesus had something in mind with that man when he asked it. Jesus didn't need his permission to healing. You all understand that? Because Jesus had something else that he was doing when he asked this man, do you want to be healed? He was asking him that for the sake of what was going on over here with the scribes and the Pharisees. Because Jesus healed that man on the Sabbath day, which you would call Sunday. What is today? Sunday. Somebody say Sunday. You know what day it is. It's Sunday. That's not a trick question. I'm not trying to trick you. Sunday. You see, because the scribes and the Pharisees and the Jewish culture said, you don't do anything on Sunday. I want you all to think about that for just a second. Because church can be that way. All these rules, walk this way, sit this way. When at this time we do this and we do this. We don't do that here. We do this here. Those are heathens over there. That church over there, all that stuff. Does this sound familiar to anybody? And what we do when we do all of that stuff is we turn people off to the word and the gospel of Jesus Christ because of a bunch of stuff that we want to do in the church. Shame on us. Help us, God. And that's what those Pharisees were doing. They're like, you can't heal people on a Sunday. Does everybody understand how ridiculous that is? Here's a man who Jesus is going to heal. And that man's going to take off, and he's going to run around. And everybody knows, you know, if you have a chronic illness, if you have something where you a limp, a smaller limb than the other one. Everybody knows that. Everybody who knows that. Everybody in your community, they know that. So here's this man running around, completely healed, who everybody had seen was jacked up, paralyzed, paraplegic, jacked up. And now he's running around, and everyone's like, just like you would. What happened to you? He says, I don't know. Some guy came to the pool, and he asked me if I wanted to be healed, and he healed me anyway, even though I didn't give him the answer. The scribes and the Pharisees are, well, we got to go find out who this is. And they found out it was Jesus, because Jesus healing people on the Sabbath. And they wanted to give him a what for, and Jesus had a lesson that he wanted to teach them. Do you want to be healed? There's some things that get in the way of our healing and get in the way of where God wants us to be. And I'm going to talk about a couple of those things today. One thing, and it's big, and it's appropriate for us today, is isolation. Everybody say isolation. Isolation. Isolation is the work of the devil. Isolation is the work of the devil. If he can isolate you, he can go to work on you. Does anyone know the story of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden? See, we always want to point the finger at Eve and be hating on women when we ought to knock it off, because the devil's over there talking to Eve, and the question needs to be asked, where's Adam? Adam, how's another man, another something, talking to your wife and you're not there? That's the question that should be asked. But what the Satan did was he isolated her so he could talk to her. You all tracking with me? Isolation has been a tool of the enemy from the very beginning. And it is contrary to the Word of God. Plain and simple. God, anyone know what the Trinity is? The Trinity? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. If you know that, say amen. That's not God alone. It isn't. He's not alone. I believe what I read over in Genesis, even when Adam was running around, I believe God said to him, it's not good that man or humans should be what? Alone. So God placed that principle in the earth. And the principles that God places in the earth, you can't change them, I can't change them, governments can't change them, time can't change them, nothing can change the principles that God placed in the earth. And he said, it's not good for us to be alone. That's what he said. Here comes 2020, the COVID year. And I wonder what happened on the COVID year. On the COVID year, a spirit hit this earth. Yes, it showed itself in a plague, in a disease over here, but something came with that plague, and something came with that, and it was a spirit of isolation. And the reason why I'm talking about it is because we still suffer from it today. And it needs to be addressed. A spirit of isolation. And a spirit of isolation is not the same as my just saying to you that COVID came and isolated people. And it isolated people to the point where we still have isolation. And we still see the effects of isolation. Did you guys know that Jesus could have come and he could have done his ministry all by himself? Anyone believe that? I mean, did Jesus turn to John, Paul, and not Paul, but John and James and the rest of them and goes, can you guys help me do this miracle over here? I need to walk on water. Can you guys like put some boards underneath there or something for me? Jesus didn't do that. But what is the first thing that Jesus did do when he was getting ready to start his ministry? He went out and got some disciples that he could do ministry with. Why? Because of what I'm telling you. What I'm saying to you is he created us that way. He created us to be with family. He created us to be in relationship. He created us. I and the Father are one. He used to say that all the time. The Father and I are one. And I'm going to send you all something, the Holy Spirit, that's one as well. But COVID comes along and isolates everybody. And now we see these ill effects. We saw them, certainly. You know, we actually got the trifecta in 2020, right? We got the trifecta. So we got the spirit of isolation that came and covered, can I say the world? Is that fair, everybody? The spirit of isolation covered the world. Let me explain it to you this way. My Bible ends in Revelation. But the book of the Bible is still being written through us and through our lives. Y'all tracking with me? So if I were to make another book after Revelation and insert it, let's call it the book of Graham. That's like the book of Billy Graham. The book of Graham. How about that? And in the book of Graham, if we were still writing, it would have, and guess what? In 1920, a spirit of COVID hit the world and isolated people by the spirit of the enemy. That would be in the book, and that would be in the Bible. That's not blasphemy, if anybody's thinking that. I'm just telling you that what happened in 2020 was of epic or biblical proportion. Okay? And we still feel it today. And the trifecta was COVID and isolation, racial hatred, separating people, isolate, 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 and the election in the political year. You think that didn't cause separation of people? Come on. Separation, isolation, isolation. Haters. We had to be so careful where I'm standing up here. If I said the word left, would you turn left when you get this street? Oh, he's a left winger. Okay, well, go down the road and turn right. Land somewhere in the middle. Oh, it's terrible. Why? People, and that spirit that was on people and is on people of isolation, they're this, they're that, they're this. I'm going to pull over here. I'm going to pull back. We still feel it today, everybody. This is the way I'm going to explain it to you. I'm going to explain it to you like this. It's done through voices. Voices in our head. You know that you're not, quote unquote, this is really a crude term, but you all know, crazy. You're not crazy when you're hearing voices in your head, necessarily. I know for sure that you have three of them that's chattering at you all the time. Three of them. The voice of God, the voice of the enemy, Satan, and you, yourself. Oh, wait a minute. Is that three? Oh, God the Father, God the Son, God. Huh. There's mind, body, soul. Oh, there's my mind that's got me, that's got the Satan, that's got, you know, God talking to me all the time. God talking to you right now. The voice is going. Some of you, the voice is going, don't listen to him. Some are listening going, that sounds right. That what he's saying, he's preaching, that sounds right, and I can get something out of that. Other people, I wonder what time he's going to finish because I'm hungry. voices, chattering in your head. And here's how the voices work, is which way are we leaning our ear? Are we leaning our ear to listen to what it is that God's saying? I wonder what he meant by, do I want to be healed today? Some of you are still kicking that around in your head, and you should be. That's the voice of God speaking to you. What did he mean by that? I'm going to listen until he gets over there to what it, and the other one, don't listen to that. See, here's what happened with this spirit of isolation. It's a spirit of isolation, and these voices that we sort of hear, and we hear them in our head, the spirit of isolation caused us to unintentionally listen more to the enemy than it does for us to listen to what God said. The same is with Adam and Eve, as what I'm telling you. I could give you a lot of examples, but for the sake of time, I'll just stick with that one. Keep it very simple. And so what happens is we're listening unintentionally. We don't mean to, but we have to remember that we're isolated. Did you do Bible studies? Did you have devotional time? What were you doing during 2020 to keep that isolation and keep plugged in with the people of God and the voice of God? So what ended up happening is we begin listening to what it is that Satan is saying. And the voice of our voice and the voice of Satan begins to be one voice. And when that happens, we don't see anything wrong with certain things that maybe in the past you might have seen something wrong with it. So in other words, let me give you an example. As Satan is coming and whispering, there's nothing wrong with it. You can sit here at home. Watch this on TV. I mean, you got the time. I wonder how many people were watching stuff and still watching it during COVID that they never watched before COVID. And they're watching it. I'm not even going to go talk about what's on the computer. I just don't even think I need to go there, because you all get what I'm talking about. And what started out as something really innocent over here, a voice started telling you that it's all right, and it's all right. And that voice began to mix with your voice. How do I know the evidence of that? Here's another example. Another evidence is that is the church isn't full. I'm going to do this online ministry. But the truth of the matter is, there's nothing in the Bible that says we're supposed to be doing online ministry. It is great, and it is a tool, and I'm not hating. But the Bible is very clear about do not forsake the fellowship of the saints. Do what you're going to do, say what you're going to say, but do not forget to come together and worship with each other. You know, that's how you get that voice out of your head that's trying to dominate in what you're doing. You get it through the filters of the people of God. Somebody say filters. You take the filters away, however that happens, and you're not filtering things properly. This is a way for you ones who are in here visiting us today that I like to say it this way. It takes every single one of us in community to even remotely understand who God is. You cannot, I repeat, you cannot understand who God is by yourself. You cannot. It's not possible. The enemy is stronger than that. And so those voices come in. You don't need to go to church. There are a bunch of hypocrites over there anyway. Well, I used to go to church. I know, but you're good. You're good. And, you know, people have said that to me. When are you going to come back to church? Oh, I'm good. That's one of the famous things we say nowadays. It's all good. No, it ain't. It ain't all good. I'm going to keep it real. Here's something else. Because families were isolated, and I don't have to give you the statistics. You know, as we're standing here right now, the family stuff is an absolute mess because of COVID. People at home beating on their wives, beating on kids, whatever. All of that stuff is that. What caused that? Isolation. Kid can't get out, can't go to school, can't interact, no isolation, right? And so we're still feeling the effects of that even today. And so that voice works out like with even within, well, I'm good. You know, my wife and I are good. We could do the Christian thing ourselves. But, you know, in a marriage, usually, and in the family, you marry someone and you have common beliefs, common ideas. Where am I going with that? If my ideas and the evil one is whispering to me, could easily become her, because even just not to keep any friction in the house. That's a good reason not to fuss and listen to someone, even when you know what they're saying or you have an inkling of what they're saying. That doesn't sound quite right. So then what happens? We end up in the spot that God never planned for us to end, and we actually never did expect or plan to attend. I was watching a video yesterday of a prophetess, and she was talking. She was talking about revival. Anyone ever heard recently since 2020 that revival is coming? Let me explain it to you this way. Devil has been trying and trying and trying to mess with God, but the devil has absolutely nothing on God. God is not now or ever going to be defeated by the devil. That's not happening. Why? Because he's God. So I'm talking to you about how the devil has raised up, right? Especially in 2020 into where. But you think that God hasn't raised up and is more powerful than the devil? Oh, come on. If you think that, then you don't know the same God that I know, and I want to introduce you to him today. Because the power of God, it wasn't even God that kicked Satan out of heaven. It wasn't even Jesus that did it. It was Michael the archangel that did it. They can't be bothered with him and the stuff like that. But the power of God is going to be greater than whatever is going on. But here's the caveat that the prophetess was talking about. Here it is. People think, this is what she said. She said, people think that revival means we're going to have a great big band of Christians that are come together, going in the stadiums, praising God and whooping up. That could happen. That's possible. But what we need to understand, she said, is revival has come to the individual. What? Revival has come to the individual who will accept the power of God. Uh-oh. That's the revival. How you all feel about that? Do you want to be healed? Has the revival of God come to you where you, me, we are walking in the power of God against all of that stuff that's out there? Because God needs us in this time of revival. He's looking. Who believes what I'm saying, knows what I'm saying, and is willing to walk in the power that I have given them when Jesus left and said, I will send you a comforter. When the comforter comes, then go. And they walked in power. Somebody say power. Do you believe that? Do you believe that today? There is this story about a prophet who was in a town. And he was prophesying and nailing it. And there was a hater. And the hater said, I'm going to go make the prophet look bad. I'm going to take this bird, a live bird. I'm going to put it behind my back. And I'm going to ask the prophet, is that bird alive or is that bird dead that I have in my hand? And if the prophet says the bird is alive, I'm going to do like this. And I'm going to squeeze him from behind and squeeze the life out of him and kill him and go, nope, the bird is dead. And if he says the bird is dead, I'm going to bring around the live bird and put him in an impossible situation. So he goes to the prophet. And he goes to the prophet and he goes, prophet, is the bird in my hand alive or is it dead? And the prophet looked at him and said, it'll be as you wish. I'm saying to you, what you receive today or don't receive will be as you wish. Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? Talking to God, I'm like, okay, God, so let's do, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to say? So I wrote some things down here that I'm going to talk to you about with that in mind. Because God said to me, somebody you're going to be talking to, is preaching with today out there, has either a right ear, in their right ear, and they have an ear infection. Or their ear canal is all clogged. It's all clogged up. Who is that? Your healing is coming today, God, in the name of Jesus. This power that you've given us, Lord, and this word that you've given me, you gave me that word because you want them to be healed. And I pray in the name of Jesus right now that the healing would come. The one that was foretold, Heavenly Father, when you made the foundations of the earth. And we pray in the name of Jesus and command the fever to go, the sickness to go. We command in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit, come in here. Open up. Infection is gone. Hearing is back. In the name of Jesus. And we thank you for it, God. Check it out. See if God didn't heal it. Come talk to me. God gave me something else as well. He said, there's someone out there. I'm reading this out of my book because I'm just like everybody else. If I don't write stuff down. And I don't want to make it up because God doesn't need for me to make it up. He's God. Somebody say God.
God.
Mm-hmm. He said, somebody out there has, and somebody online probably could have had that as well. So I'm not only talking to the couple people who were in here, I'm talking to you who are online as well. Someone has a left leg injury or something just right up above the ankle, right in here in by the tendon and right in here by the bone. And it's been sore and it's been hurting. Who is that? Okay. So I pray, God, by the name of Jesus, the name that's above all names, God, that right now that pain is gone, that soreness is gone, that hurting is gone. The tendon is returning to normal, God, in the name of Jesus. More power and more Holy Spirit over here. More power and more Holy Spirit over here. And I pray, God, in the name of Jesus, even as I wave my hand back and forth, that somebody in this room gets a drive-by healing in the name of Jesus, because your power and your authority is here. And I ask him a question, God. Do you want to be healed? And somebody in here wants to be healed. And I pray for them right now, God, that their healing has come and is here now. Amen. At this church, what we want to do is we want to do life with you. For real. You got to have things that are going on in your life that God never intended for you, and part of it is because of what I just said a minute ago and about what I was talking about. And today, some of that stuff, God wants to come in there and begin to clean out and clear some of that stuff. So healing is here in the room. It's not only the physical healing. We have some people in this room that are lonely. Some of you who are watching online, you've been watching online. You probably even haven't left your house in months. And you're lonely and you're isolated. Someone in here feels isolated and lonely. Someone else in here is hurt and feels abandoned and like no one cares and no one loves you. Those are lies from the pit of hell, and I cast them even now at the foot of that cross. Because Jesus died to save you. Who is this? Somebody has anger issues. Which COVID did to you? You were never an angry, bitter person before. And now you have this spirit of anger that you never had before. And God wants to take that from you today. He does. And he heads bowed and eyes closed. Jesus, Jesus, thank you, Father. Glory to you, God. Ooh, it is so good to be in your presence, God, and get a little bit of whatever is going on in heaven to get it here on earth today, right now. Thank you, God. Jesus. I want to pray for you. And I want to pray for you. I'm not going to stand up here for an hour and pray over an individual, but I am going to lay hands on you. But before I do that, with all heads bowed and all eyes closed, I ask you again, do you want to be healed? And if you want to be healed, you just might have to get up out of that seat and come up here. Was that you that I got that word about with those angry issues? Someone feeling lonely and isolated. I mean, you are around people. You are around friends. You are around family. But you still feel like no one understands you. No one gets you. I'm alone. Come on. Let me pray for you today. Derek, give them the elements, would you please? We're going to take a minute and take communion. And I don't believe that God is finished with what he's doing in here. I just don't. I believe that God has got something for some of you, and if you don't come up here and get it, I'm going to come over there where you are so you can get it. I'm going to stand in the shoes of Jesus and ask you if you want to be healed today. And the answer that God has for us today, the answer is yes. I've got one. Communion. Hopefully those of you who are at home have had time to go and get some elements, get a cracker. a saltine cracker or whatever and some juice, and you have time. I'll give you another couple minutes to go get that ready. I believe that somebody's going to be healed of something in your body today, even when you take that communion. Because it's about the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And my Bible says over in Isaiah, it says that by his stripes, I'm healed. And so we do this, we take this in remembrance of who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. And so even when we take these elements, we're saying, I believe in you, God. This is not about ordinance. This is not about, this is the third Sunday, this is what we do. This is about my, in my heart and in my spirit, I want to be one with you, God. I want your spirit and the spirit of the one and true living God to be alive, active in my life. More of that in my life today. So as Jesus took his disciples into the upper room, that's what he was telling them. He said, take this, eat this. And you know, when you eat something, I'm not going to get all off into the DNA, non-GMO, and all that stuff. But you know that when we consume something, that's what Jesus is saying. Consume me. Live for me. Let my voice in your head be louder than all the other voices of the world and the things around you. That's what he wants for you today. So as we think about that, we take this wafer. In our minds, we can close our eyes. We can see Jesus on that hill. He can see Jesus on that cross. We can see Jesus with that blood streaming down his side and down his face. And he said, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. So we ask you to forgive us, and by the blood and the stripes of Jesus, someone is healed today. And we remember, take and eat. Likewise, he took the cup. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you, and this is the blood, which is going to be shed for the remission of sins. And so I ask God in the name of Jesus that not only you forgive me of my sins, but you forgive everyone under the sound of my voice. And today is not only a changing day for them, but it's a new day by the blood of Jesus. Take and drink. Everyone take your hands, put them like this. I'm in receiver mode. That's what this is. Yes, thank you, God. And so, Heavenly Father, God, as everyone is here and they're listening, God, and they're in receiving mode, God, I pray that you come down with your power and you come down with your Holy Spirit, Lord, and you supply their needs, every single one of them, according to your riches, which are in glory. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this time. I pray the Holy Spirit on everyone that they will walk in the power and authority, be revived today in the name of Jesus. And let the church say. Amen. Miss Vicki and myself are going to stay up here. And if you want to come up for prayer, come on. In other words, we'll see you next week. God bless you.
If you gave your life to Christ today, we'd like to celebrate with you. Please text SAVED to 833-535-0980. We believe it's important to stay connected, so please text CMC Connect to 833-535-0980, and we will reach out to you. Thank you for joining us, and have a blessed day.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise.